We want to welcome you to Yale Divinity School for a very important discussion. My name is Greg Sterling. I'm the Dean of the Divinity School. All of us who are concerned about Christianity in this country and the world have seen Christianity change markedly. And if I can think of it within my own lifetime, I have seen enormous changes. So in my lifetime, 50% of the people who have grown up in mainline Protestant traditions have left. That the Episcopal Church, for example, is closing 50 parishes a year. There is a freeze on ordinations in Connecticut because there's no place to put people. That's one example. If we think of the Association of Theological Schools, there are 270 schools accredited by ATS. When I was born, about 60% of those were mainline Protestants, 20% evangelical, 20% Catholic. Today, it's 40% mainline Protestant, 40% evangelical, and 20% Catholic. If you think of these groups, if you think of evangelicals, they have had a rise, but in recent years, even they have begun to decline within the last 5 years. And the result is, for the first time in the history of this country, Protestants are now less than 50% of the population. If you think of Catholicism, 60% of white Americans who've grown up as Roman Catholics have left the church of their youth. Catholicism has been Latinized, so it has remained stable in terms of its share of the American population, but principally on the basis of immigration. And in 2010, the American Roman Catholic Church had 40% representation by Latinos, Latinas. Today, 20% of Americans, adults, are unaffiliated with any religious tradition. That's a 5% increase in 5 years, or 1% per annum increase, which is a huge increase if you think of it on a longitudinal basis.
It's really nice to be here. I was here in the year 1984, 85. And as the years have passed since then, I realize that I have forgotten a great deal of what I thought I'd learned. But I will never, never forget the kindness of those who taught me. They really lived what they professed. Well, to get us started, maybe we can just pick up from where the dean left off. I would be very interested in hearing briefly from each of you about how we all got into this mess, Diana.
Oh.
I think you mean this opportunity.
let me just do a little bread and butter work here. Diana's book is Christianity After Religion, and Ross's is Bad Religion, How We Became a Nation of Heretics. I'm sorry, Diana.
When you ask the question about how we got to where we are now, the historian in me wants to have you all sign up for a 13-week class, and we could talk about it for a long time. But you know, I think the simplest thing, from the perspective at least of the Yale audience, was that in the middle part of the 20th century, the institutions of religious life that we had in the United States were extraordinarily successful. And it was in some ways the success that got us to the place where we are now. As the culture began to change around those institutions, they just continued living off of what I would call the capital of an earlier age of religious life. And so a lot of the institutions that are now in crisis simply did not notice how there was developing a disconnect between the strong places of worship and the strong seminaries and all of those sort of leading organizations of religious life and what was happening in the culture around them. And that disconnect, at first I think some of those institutions just said, oh, this is kind of a fad, these problems are gonna go away. people will come back to church, but after four decades, we can see now that there was a real problem with the structure of the churches and institutions we had vis-a-vis the culture. And so they just didn't speak to one another any longer. It's like a really bad divorce.
You wrote, conventional comforting Christianity has failed. It doesn't work.
I wrote that, huh?
In fairness, let me now quote something that Ross said, or I don't know whether he wrote it, but it's on the dust jacket anyway.
Oh, now that's actually, there are laws against dust jacket.
He called what happened the slow motion, or the dust, the whoever wrote the copy on the dust, the slow motion collapse of traditional faith and the rise of a variety of pseudo-Christianities that stroke our egos, indulge our follies, and encourage our worst impulses. Did you write that?
Somebody did. It's on the desk. Yeah. Well, no. So this is probably the part of the afternoon where Diana and I will agree the most, because I think we look at these trends and see something relatively similar. I mean, I would phrase it a little bit differently. I think if you look at American Christianity at mid-century and you look at the kind of institutional strength and vitality at that point, I think what happens is an era of crisis that was understood as an era of crisis even at the time in the 1960s and 70s. I don't think it was just that the institution sort of breezily went on doing what they'd been doing before. I think that there were and have been and continue to be all kinds of attempts to adapt to the new landscape that sort of cultural revolution ushered in. But I mean, basically the way I sort of argue it in the book is that if you look at the 60s and 70s, you can see sort of four big forces that undercut the kind of, Christian establishments of the post-war period. And one is obviously the sexual revolution, which I'm sure we'll dive into a bit more, but just sort of the sense more sort of post-1960s and pre-1960s that traditional Christian sexual ethics were just sort of out of step with the way people lived and might be actively perverse and patriarchal and so on. So you have the sexual revolution, you have, I think, sort of economic shifts, and particularly just sort of the straightforward fact of America's incredible wealth the United States, starting in the post-war period, continuing, notwithstanding the Great Recession to the present day, is basically the wealthiest society in all of human history. And just as sort of the shifts of the sexual revolution sort of rubbed up against certain New Testament passages, shall we say, in certain uncomfortable ways. Maybe that's a poor imagery for something associated with sex, but we'll leave it there. In the same way, the sort of economic revolution in American life created some obvious disconnects between what sort of traditional Christianity says about the dangers of materialism and wealth and so on in the way we live. So you have sex and you have money, and then I think you have political polarization and the extent to which the sort of the stuff that I, for my sins, write about mostly in my day job, the sort of sorting of America's two political parties into very streamlined, ideologically coherent groups, clearly liberal, clearly conservative in ways that wasn't true in the past, has just made it harder for Christians, individuals, preachers, pastors, churches, intellectuals, whoever, to find a place to stand where you're identified as a Christian first and a conservative or a liberal second. I think this was a big problem for the Christian left in the 60s and 70s. I think it became a big problem in obvious ways for the Christian right over the last 20 years. And again, there hasn't been an obvious solution. And then last, I think you had globalization. And obviously we've had globalization in various forms going back to Christopher Columbus. But I think the sort of the way that process was accelerated by television and then the internet, the sort of dizzying diversity of the world beamed into American living rooms and computers as never before, I think it made people just, I think, naturally more relativistic in ways that didn't mean that people were less spiritually inclined or less religious. It just made it harder for people to say, okay, my particular Methodist, Presbyterian, Catholic, whatever church is the one true church. I mean, look how wild and crazy and complicated the world is. That can't possibly be right. So I think those, obviously there are many other trends, but in a book you have to sort of pick a big four, and those are the four that I start with that I think are, you know, still with us and still accelerating today.
But Diana, what I find so really interesting is that in spite of all this, in spite of all the polls, all the numbers, all the bad news, you still find enough evidence of life on this sick tradition, life, so that you can claim to see another great awakening.
Yeah, it's...
What do you see?
My husband actually refers to me as the Balaam's ass of hope. And
what do you call him?
I won't tell you what I call him in public, but
that's for the second session.
But you know, I'm actually not a terribly optimistic person, and I can go with the worst sort of moments of despair as anyone. But when it's all said and done, I looked at what was going on in the world around me, and what I began to see were patterns that were very similar to other periods of great religious change in North America and in other parts of church history. So when you hear sort of all this talk about the failure of institutions, or you see a disconnect between established church and the longings of people in the culture that are around the church, you can almost always guarantee in church history that something is about to happen. You can see that kind of disconnect develop around the High Middle Ages, and the Franciscan movement developed out of that. You can see it happening again, just to name a few of these moments, around the Protestant Reformation, where the institutional church is not reaching people in meaningful ways in their local lives. And so there begins to get this pressure and this longing to do something different. And then, of course, I think the greatest example, in many ways parallel to where we are now, is the historical moment around the Wesleyan revival of the middle part of the 18th century. In England, of course, you have an established church, and that established church had boundaries, parish boundaries, and that's where the church was and
how
the church preached.
What are the characteristics of these? What are the characteristics of this that you see?
Well, the first thing is actually the longing. And I was on the phone not too long ago with a group of nuns who hang out with Richard Rohr. And they asked me what gave me hope. And I said, well, one of the things that has actually given me hope is there's so much anger about religious life in America today. And the nuns, I wasn't even thinking about this, but they started laughing on the other end of the phone and said, well, if anger is a sign of hope, then the Catholic Church is the most hopeful institution on the planet right now. And they said, well, how can that be? And I said, well, anger indicates that people care. And that folks are still invested in some way, shape, or form in wanting these institutions to meet up to their ideals, and that I think that they actually want the institutions to be responsive to their concerns. And so that first piece, that the very longing or the very anger that's present in our culture around these trends of leaving, I think is actually a sign of hope.
But you talk about people saying they're spiritual but not religious, mm-hmm. that people are all kinds of things. And Ross, is what Diana is describing bad religion? Is it heresy?
The anger?
No.
Probably not.
No, the character the characteristics of the nuns, N-O-N-E-S.
Yeah, and I do argue that it right. has to be, uh-huh. that I do argue that there's a more experiential form of faith right. that's emerging.
Well, I mean, so. I think if we back up, though, and look at, let's say the 60s through the 80s, right? The sort of period when this, whatever we want to call it, crisis started. I think you can look back on that era and say it looks in certain ways like a classic Great Awakening moment, right? You have a fascination with ecstatic forms of spirituality that run the gamut from sort of the religious element in the drug culture all the way to sort of Pentecostalism, the vineyard, and so on. You have obviously a questioning of church authorities, you have, you know, new figures, new holy men, new leaders who spring up, and you can see it depending on what questions you look at in opinion polls, you know, if you ask the percentage of Americans, say, who say they have had a direct encounter of with the divine, goes way up from the 50s through the 1990s. The percentage of Americans who say they believe in life after death went up between the 40s and the 1990s. So I agree with you that the moment we're living in now, you know, shares some characteristics in common with previous Great Awakening periods. I think the whole sort of sweep of the crisis facing institutional churches has had those characteristics in common. What's been different, at least so far, is that either existing institutional churches or new forms of institutional religion haven't succeeded in channeling that energy in the way that, for instance, the Methodists ultimately did, but other bodies as well. I mean, if you go back to periods of awakening in the 19th century, speaking, you know, you don't think of, for instance, the Catholic Church as being particularly associated with great awakenings in the American past. We think of it as a sort of primarily Protestant low church phenomenon and so on. But in fact, the Catholic Church in the US did a really remarkable job of sort of designing pilgrimages and festivals and so on in ways that captured and channeled sort of that kind of bubbling spiritual energy. And I think you see this again and again in American history, that part of the reason that institutional religion has remained as resilient as it has in the US is precisely that it has not just been undone by these moments of turmoil and sort of new enthusiasms and so on. It has found, not every church obviously, but churches have found ways to thrive. And that is what I think hasn't happened yet. And probably the place where you and I disagree the most is just over the question of to what extent is that kind of institutional element in religion necessary for Christianity, period, going forward? To what extent is this failure really a failure, right?
I do think there are some moments of the sort of the institutional response to the energy. I like the way you talk about the bubbling up. one of the characteristics that's common in each one of the previous American awakenings is that after you get through the period of awakening, there are more people sitting at the table of leadership than there were before the awakening started. So you can actually look at the first Great Awakening and see how American religion and American politics changed and broadened to include more people who were sitting at the table, who had voice and were sharing power. The second Great Awakening, the reaching out towards women and slaves, that was a huge part of broadening the table, as it were. The third Great Awakening, I love that you brought up Catholics, because I actually am well aware that these awakening patterns echoed in Catholicism, particularly strongly in the Third Great Awakening, when there were so many more Catholics here, but also in Jewish communities as well. And so you get to the end of the Third Great Awakening, and all of a sudden the United States is not just Protestant, but it's Protestant, Catholic, and Jewish. So there's more people around the table. Now, this is one of the things that I think is actually a struggle right now in institutional religion, is that some of the churches that are represented here have been working to bring more people around the table. And so when it comes to thinking about the sexual revolution, there is actually an institutional response to that, and that is women clergy, more voices and serious power at the table, the inclusion of gay and lesbian people in open and productive and life-giving ways in all these traditions, and that's bringing more people around the table. And so I look at the inclusion of women and LGBT folks as a real sign of awakening, whereas I know that there are some people who look at that as a sign of the decline, but I see it as a sign of the future.
Well, but here's the question then, right? I mean, if that pattern is as you describe it, why, at least to date, has that kind of spirit of inclusion not brought the kind of response that I think many people in mainline denominations expected it to, right? I mean, I think that, you know, we started out talking about to what extent is it just a question of sort of churches remaining on a particular trajectory while the culture changes? But I think the guiding assumption of many mainline churches has been precisely as you said, that in this changing, globalized, post-sexual revolution world, we need to broaden our tent in various ways, and then the pews will fill as a result. And that hasn't happened. I mean, there are specific places where it has happened. This is a country of 300 million people, and there are vibrant churches and communities of all kinds. But I think, you know, demographically speaking, as much as every church has struggled in different ways, the mainline struggle has been particularly acute, right?
Yes.
But let me interrupt a minute.
Okay.
Look at history is wonderful, but tell me what you see right now, and tell me what is the matter with that. I mean, if people want to worship in very different ways, if they want to go to yoga class or meditate or something that's not quite as traditional in this country as something
burn
might be.
The yoga class. I leave you with one. No, I'm sorry.
What?
That's a joke.
But what's the matter with all this experimentation?
I'm looking at a couple people out in that audience.
I think we're looking at more than a couple. What? So you're at me first?
I'm asking you, what's the matter with these things that you complain about, of people worshiping in very different ways and not necessarily in the traditional way of the traditional church?
I mean, I think that it's a question of balance, right? And, you know, every form of religion has sort of characteristic errors that it falls into, and any kind of institutional, certainly any kind of hierarchical church is going to fall prey to various forms of clericalism, corruption, and a sort of, you know, a spiritual aridity, if you will, that sort of newer, more experiential, more personal forms of faith can serve as a corrective towards. But when I look at the state of religion in the U.S. today, I don't see a population sort of weighed down by the oppressive demands of sort of traditional hierarchical religion. You know, maybe there are communities within the United States where that's the case, but for the most part, I think the pendulum has swung the other way, and I think it's swung very far the other way, and when it swings that far, I think you run into the opposite kind of problem, which is basically the tendency to sort of pursue the God who you find within yourself and not sort of correct or challenge that experience with, you know, let's call it the wisdom of the past, the wisdom of larger religious communities. And so my book is, for instance, somewhat critical of the best-selling memoir, Eat, Pray, Love, which some of you may have had occasion to read or see the movie with Julia Roberts. And I hadn't read that book before I started working on my own book. And what's striking about Eat, Pray, Love from if you haven't read it before, if you just sort of know of it as this cultural phenomenon, where it's this woman and she goes to different places and you're like, oh, she must be this total dilettante and so on. No, in fact, what's striking about that book is how authentic Elizabeth Gilbert's spiritual quest really is and how sort of raw and direct her encounter with the divine is and how big a challenge in certain ways it poses to the sort of secular milieu in which she grew up and in which many of us spend a lot of our time and so on. And so the religion in Eat, Pray, Love is very real, but what's striking about the book is the extent to which the experiences Elizabeth Gilbert has seem to be the only way she could imagine ever encountering God. And I'm being a little bit unfair here, but I think, for instance, you know, it's useful to compare her spiritual quest to, you know, a sort of religious conversion narrative in the style of Thomas Merton or Dorothy Day or, you know, St. Augustine, to go all the way back and so on. And there is in that sort of traditional narrative a real conversion where you leave an old life behind and take on a new life and a new, ultimately, system of belief. And I would have been more impressed with Eat, Pray, Love if Elizabeth Gilbert had gone to India, had a direct encounter with God in an ashram, and become a Hindu, right? If had sort of said, okay, this is where I encountered God, and this is a religious system that goes back thousands of years and has, you know, countless debates and interpretations and texts, and I'm going to submit myself to it and not just assume that the direct way I encounter God is giving me the sort of fullness of religious faith. And I think when you don't do that, and I think this is our culture's besetting sin, you just end up again and again sort of baptizing your ego or your libido or your desire for financial gain. And this is not a sort of liberal versus conservative phenomenon. I think you see the same thing in a figure like Joel Osteen and the sort of prosperity preaching. But so that's what's wrong with it, right? It's a, you know, there, I think in a healthy spiritual life, which to be clear, I am describing and not claiming to be living, but in a healthy spiritual life, you want a balance between personal experience and some form of authority, scriptural, traditional, communal, that's larger than yourself. And that's what I think we've lost.
Well, one of the things, I actually really appreciate everything that you just point out there, Ross. And what I am sort of asking myself, to go back to the historical place for a moment, is that the Methodist Church did not spring forth from Wesley's imagination full-orbed in 1740 when he was preaching. Originally, the need to get born again, have a heart strangely warmed. What happened first was this conversion, this powerful personal encounter that the early Methodists had with God. And that led them to sort of break with institutional structures, not because they were being mean, but because they felt that the structures weren't adequate to communicate the experience that they'd had. And so they went out and eventually formed small groups, and they eventually founded churches in places where there weren't churches. And then it was some 50 years later that you really get something in the United States that begins to be the Methodist Church. So I kind of wonder the way in which you're describing the situation, which again, I don't find that I disagree with your assessment terribly much. We never disagree on the assessment, I think, when we talk about these things. But I think that it's just part of a process, and that we're sort of still very much in the early stages of it, and that the institutional reorientation piece might be another decade or two off. And I actually think we will have structure out of this, but it's going to be a sort of broader, perhaps even more decentralized structure, and that we can't even kind of imagine what it's going to be quite yet. I think that we're kind of moving towards it, but it has not yet arrived.
But let me push you a little bit on that. What do you see coming? You look around and you see trends. Let's extrapolate on that. What do you think they're going to lead to? Is it going to be more and more of a kind of do-it-yourself, God-within sort of non-institutional worship? Or is it going to be something different? What do you see? What do you see, and what would you like to see?
I'm going to have to get the Pope on the phone for the second question. But for the first, I think it can be actually both at once. I think the story of American religious culture right now is the same story as American culture writ large, which is just a general deinstitutionalization, right? And this is the element that's sort of implicit in what we've been saying. But you know, it isn't just churches, right? It's not just Americans' attitudes towards churches, it's their attitudes towards their political leaders and their, you know, towards Wall Street, and it's the fact that they aren't joining the Elks Lodge, or, you know, they're bowling alone in the famous Robert Putnam phrase, and so on. It's the fact that people aren't forming families as often as they used to, and those families split up more than they used to, and so on. So there is this sort of broad drift away from all forms of community, really, in American life. And it's a little bit of a late to tell, but I think I'll put on my techno-pessimist hat for a minute and say that I think the internet overall seems to be furthering these trends more than it's pushing back against them, that the forms of virtual community that the online world provides are not sufficient for most people's substitutes for actual flesh and blood contact, but that your mileage may vary on that point of view. So overall, in that sense, I expect the rise of the nuns to continue for a while. But then at the same time, if you then zero into sort of American communities, if you look at the places that are most resilient, right, the places that have the most stable family life, the places that, you know, ultimately have the most social mobility, the most sort of resilience and so on, those are often places that either still have or have sort of new forms of religious community. And so I think you would expect a sort of, you know, these sort of, to get to what I hope to see, I suppose I would say I hope to see those what can feel like pockets right now, and sometimes fairly provincial pockets, to expand and to ultimately sort of fill in this sort of within this broader picture of sort of social dislocation and atomization and so on. But I don't think, you know, it's a very hard question to. It's very hard to tell in the race between sort of atomization on the one hand, and the sort of advantages in terms of social capital and family stability that you get from being part of a religious community on the other hand, which one wins, right? If people in religious communities are having more kids, for instance, right, which they are, does that matter more, or does the wider culture control and those kids, you know, you have five kids and three of them drift away and so on? And I don't know the answer to that, but that's sort of how I see the sort of broad landscape.
But another way to put the same question, in terms of society as a whole, especially public life, what do you expect to come out of this situation that we're in?
Well, I have kind of almost an answer that matches the framework of your last question. I have what I fear and what I hope. What I fear is not so much atomization as you're explaining, but I actually fear clustering in negative ways. So I think that people can form communities that are so isolated from one another that they're atomized communities. And so we're almost getting kind of a gated effect in religion, spirituality, that resembles what's been happening around politics. And so that's one of the things I fear, is that our public life will be even more deeply shaped by these broken away, disconnected kinds of communities where their theology reigns and that they have no engagement with anyone else's worldview. Which leads me to what I hope will happen, is that part of the reason I actually love mainline churches, it's a terrible love affair. it's unrequited so many times. But part of the reason I love mainline churches is also part of the reason I love Catholic churches. And that is, they got people together who came from so many different social locations. And that it wasn't just about supporting the same old, but it was actually about breaking down boundaries between class and between ethnicities and between social location, so that people could encounter each other in a meaningful way around meal and hospitality and forgiveness and all of these practices that are so important. And so my dream is not necessarily that every mainline church will grow again or that every Catholic parish will be huge again, but that whatever comes out of all of this, that the new communities we form will connect people across the boundaries that divide rather than serve the isolation of the communal division we currently have. And so that's why I think that's what I hope will happen with our public life, that religion can once again be in a place where it's helpful rather than reinforcing negative patterns of human gathering. So we might be well past that, but.
Well, I guess I would just dispute a little bit the premise that those are always negative patterns of human gathering, because I think that, you know, if you look at, for instance, the sort of most successful moments in recent American Catholic history, right? I mean, the most thriving U.S. Catholic parishes and the most successful U.S. Catholic communities tended to be rooted in shared ethnicity, right? And they were rooted in shared ethnicity in ways that I think promoted a sort of healthy diversity within unity, where you had, you know, you had the Polish parish and you had the Irish parish and you had the Italian parish, and maybe you got in fistfights with the Irish kids on the playground if you were the Italian kid and so on. But I don't think that we should sneer at those kind of divisions, because I think it's very hard to form communities without those. I mean, I think one of the lessons of American life over the last 30 or 40 years is that it's harder than people think to form community. And obviously, right, as Christians, we're called to form communities that do sort of transcend those kind of narrower allegiances of family and bloodline and so on. But it is also the case that you can't ignore them. When, like, you know, if you're the American Catholic Church right now, you can't just look at your Hispanic population and say, you know, well, our goal has to be just to integrate them into diverse, you know, diverse existing parishes. That has to be part of the goal, but part of the goal, as with previous waves of immigration, has to be to meet those immigrants where they are. And one of the big failures of American Catholicism, one of the reasons that so many Hispanics are becoming Pentecostalist, evangelical, and so on, is that enough, you know, the church hasn't been able to mobilize the kind of resources in those communities that it did, in part through sort of transatlantic cross-pollination with Ireland, with Irish immigrants in a previous era. So I agree that that sort of balkanization obviously carries dangers, but it is also important when you're thinking about, you know, how to build successful parishes to recognize that up to a point you have to work with the grain of human, you know, human loyalties.
What do you think is going to happen to the old idea that we were all supposed to go out and try to help build the kingdom? We were have to practice social action. We were to help make a better world. What do you see that? Is that part of what's going on or not?
That idea, I actually have a few paragraphs about that in Christianity After Religion. The idea of building the kingdom is really a classical liberal idea that we've essentially come to the end of. Now, it doesn't mean that Christians aren't interested in thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. A good friend of mine who Ross doesn't like in his book.
but not in his book, that's a totally different role.
We don't know no, about in okay. person yeah. Dom Crossan actually says that the prayer says thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, because earth is where the problem is, heaven's just fine. And so there is still, I think, clearly within Christian theology this idea of modeling, embodying, practicing the kingdom of God in and through our societies. But it's not about building the kingdom. I think it's about practicing the kingdom in anticipation of what God's intention is for all humankind. And so here I think that our theology is moving past the old categories of liberal and conservative and beginning to create a sort of a new possible ethical framework, which I hope and think will be part of the awakening.
Yeah, and I agree, actually, and I think that that is in certain ways a sort of positive convergence between liberal Protestantism and especially younger evangelicalism, where you have on the evangelical side a sort of move away from, you know, this is going back decades, but a move away from the sort of withdrawal from the world, you know, await the apocalypse mentality, but also then a sort of move, a sort of disillusionment with the political efforts of the religious right. And then I think in the liberal Protestant world, you have a certain mix of sort of disillusionment and realism about what that, you know, Harvey Cox moment in American Protestant history actually ultimately delivered. And so I do think, you know, if you look at sort of younger evangelicals are in general still very politically conservative, more likely to be sort of engaged in charitable endeavors, especially on a global scale, and a little bit more cynical in, I think, a healthy way about the Republican Party. And perhaps in a similar way, younger liberal Protestants might be, you know, have a healthier attitude towards politics. Yeah. You know, it's the difference between, yeah, I think building the kingdom versus
practicing
is a good distinction.
I want to interrupt there so that we can hear from anybody here with a question or a comment.
Anybody who isn't related to me.
My name's Rommel San Pedro. I'm a minister. I'm also an attorney for the Iglesia de Cristo. The question regarding the book that you wrote there, you mentioned it's a great recession, a religious recession. Isn't it more like a depression? Isn't it not just America, but worldwide? I'd like both of you to comment on that.
I sort of like Paul Krugman, I guess I would want to call it a little depression rather than a great depression. Certainly in Western cultures, that which used to be Christendom, it might be a depression in parts of Europe, a little depression in Canada, and a great recession here in the United States. So in those places, that's true. But then we've got the corresponding sort of other pattern, which is this explosion of experiential religion on the rest of the planet, in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. So I think that this is all sort of part of the same kind of reaching towards new religious identity and new spiritual identity around the globe, but it's happening very different vis-a-vis what the history of the group, of the culture was in relationship to Western Christianity. Mm-hmm.
No, and I think that that is exactly, that last bit is exactly the right way of looking at it, that one of the striking things about sort of decolonization, for instance, is that it seems to have simultaneously created a kind of crisis of confidence for Christians in the West, who look at sort of the history of imperialism and their church's relationship to it and so on, and sort of you know, feel an understandable guilt about sort of Christian complicity in those structures of oppression. But then at the same time, the sort of lifting of that association between Christianity and the colonial power in a lot of the developing world, particularly sub-Saharan Africa, but also in Asia as well, has, you know, in general, been an incredibly positive thing for Christian witness. And it's very hard to imagine, I think, the kind of explosive growth of Christianity in large parts of the developing world over the last 40 years without that sort of separation between Christianity and sort of Western rule.
Mm-hmm. Could we have?
Sure. I'm wondering if you would attribute any of the current change, turmoil, ferment, transformation in American Christianity to the decline of American power in recent decades, and to the possibility that the American church hitched its wagon a little bit too tightly to that power over the past half century or so?
I think in a general way, not really. In part because I think when we talk about the decline of American power, you know, it's been much more of a sort of flow and ebb and flow and ebb, you know, with a sort of general decline from this unique moment after World War II when every other developed country in the world was basically flattened. But, you know, if I mean, this is where these discussions are a little time-bound. If you went back 10 or 12 or 13 years, nobody would be talking about the decline of American power, but a lot of the deeper trends we're talking about would be there nonetheless. However, I think in the specific case of a certain style of conservative Christianity, I do think there's a link, and it's unprovable, but I think it's sort of palpable nonetheless, between the way the Bush presidency played out and the way the sort of internal confidence of that worldview and the way it's sort of viewed by people outside it. I think if the Bush presidency, I mean, I see the Bush presidency in part as sort of this, in part as sort of culmination of the attempt among Catholics and evangelicals to sort of build a united front in the culture war, mostly against, you know, the liberal Protestantism and so on, but also just,
okay,
you know, just this sense, well, but, you know, but then it all fell apart, right? I mean, yeah. I think that the sort of the post 9/11 moment when there was sort of seemingly this uncomplicated relationship between, you know, Christianity, American patriotism, sort of American strength and resolve, that was a moment that could have been a good moment, ultimately, for a certain style of conservative Christianity in the U.S., and the fact that things unfolded as they did meant that it went in the opposite direction. And sort of the role that a figure like a Sarah Palin plays in our national sort of debates and the images people have of religion and so on, I think in a world where Sarah Palin had been a different kind of figure, where, you know, she had given flawless, fluent interviews and so on. It's not that that would literally cause people to stay in the pews, but it's, you know, these things have ripple effects, right? And sort of people's ideas about religious ideas and values and institutions are shaped by what they see in politics. So I think that there's been some impact, at least, in sort of the crisis of conservatism has had some impact on the crisis of conservative Christianity,
yes,
at least.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
The question that I had and would like you to comment on, during the 2008 primary, America got a 15-second soundbite of a glimpse into African-American church life, mm-hmm, in the midst of a heat of a political campaign. And the result of it was, I think, in many ways, a kind of misunderstanding of the role and function of religion in African-American communities, and especially Christianity in African-American communities. Yeah. In light of what you both shared with us, I want to know what observations do you have about the impact of these broad social developments on a sometimes neglected segment of American Christianity, which is African-American Christianity.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, that's a great question. I actually wrote a piece for Huffington Post that went viral defending Reverend Wright and talking about how what I heard in that sermon was the echoes of slave religion and a sort of a deep kind of revolutionary African-American theology. And so that went out, and a lot of people read it, and I got some really wonderful responses from it. But I think that one of the things that it does to sort of my soul, as it were, is reminds me how feeble our theological vocabulary has become in the public square. And this is a place where actually I appreciate Ross's work very much, because he points towards this and he says that when we lose these sorts of institutions, we lose theological vocabulary that helps us to understand a whole variety of our voices. And so if you have a fractured, divided culture where there's a lot of people who misunderstand religion, there's great possibility for the misunderstanding of Sarah Palin, even though she could have said it better. It's like, she's a Pentecostal. And a lot of the stuff that she said was really, could be quite understood within a framework of her religious and faith life. And the same with Reverend Wright. And so that's that kind of loss of hearing one another well through those theological lenses, to me, is something that's very sad. And I'm afraid that we're leaving it behind in the end of the 20th century. And I don't know if anything's going to help us to recover any level of that in the 21st century. But I do think if we could listen and explain things better through these theological lenses, that we might have a running shot at talking more civilly to each other.
I mean, I would just say something quickly about the black church, which is that in certain ways, I think it's a fascinating exception to, I think the biggest problem for liberal Christianity in the U.S. over the last 40 or 50 years has been that it has lost sight of the sort of theological taproot of its political convictions. So speaking as a political conservative, I don't want to live in a world where there is no liberal Christianity, right? I want to live in a world where there are people who are serious political liberals who are also serious Christians. And I, you know, sort of, to put it crudely, who are sort of political liberals and theological conservatives, but that's the crude way of putting it. But the sort of more nuanced way is just that, you know, who are political liberals who take biblical religion seriously. And so the strength of the black church over the last few generations has been its ability to sort of maintain that balance in ways that many white liberal churches have not. I think the peril for the black church, and again, I'm speaking obviously as an outsider to these debates and so on, but there is this sort of generational gap between the sort of Jeremiah Wright generation, right, which is very politicized in a seriously theological way, but is obviously, you know, its views of American society are informed by Jim Crow and slavery before that and so on, and it has an essentially sort of revolutionary vision. And then that doesn't match up onto the lives of a lot of especially middle class and upper middle class African Americans today, but that void then has often been filled by prosperity preachers of various kinds.
That's
right?
True.
So this sort of dominant, non-radical, non-Jeremiah Wright form of African American theology too often now is a sort of, you know, a sort of God wants you to do well in the suburbs of Atlanta kind of pitch. And I think so that's the threat,
right,
in certain ways to that sort of successful, the more successful maintenance of the balance within the black church.
For what it's worth, most liberals I know think they're theological and conservatives are political.
Well, I have met a few political conservatives. Yes,
which is, I think, part of the problem.
Thank you so much.
Sir.
Hi, thank you both for your comments today. My name is Justin List, and I'm a YDS grad from 2004 and an internal medicine resident at Yale New Haven Hospital. And one thing, it's a broad question, but to the best you can address it, I'm really interested in your thoughts on the 20% that are increasingly not religious, and how you see that 20% in light of a growth in urban life, cosmopolitanism, and a lack of people like Niebuhr who sort of espouse that public theology, that language that we sort of missing now. So how do you see the rise in sort of massive urban cosmopolitan life interfacing with a younger generation and sort of less commitment to an organized religious structure?
one of the interesting things that came out of the polls on the nuns, the 20%, was that overwhelmingly the young ones were Democrats.
Yeah. I've never heard anybody put the 20% and Reinhold Niebuhr in the same sentence. And so,
you really? I swear I've heard it at least.
Oh my gosh. I don't think that good old Reinhold.
Isn't there a rule that every sentence has to have Reinhold Niebuhr in it though, with these kind of?
I call it the Reinhold Niebuhr, if only Reinhold Niebuhr were still alive, school of church.
I mean, I started my book with Reinhold Niebuhr.
I know you did, I laughed when I saw that, because everybody thinks Reinhold Niebuhr could come back from the dead and fix it. you know, I don't think even Reinhold Niebuhr could fix this.
You were the public theologian.
Right. Well, you know, I think that there is actually a lot of really interesting public theology going on, but it's not going on necessarily through the channels that we expect. You know, I think of somebody like Shane Claiborne with a Simple Way Community down in Philadelphia, or my really good friend Jonathan Wilson Hartgrove, who started a similar neo-monastic community in Durham, North Carolina. Those two guys are serious theologians. With actually serious academic pedigrees and who are walking their talk, and they are writing theology. It's just not that they're not on the cover of Time magazine. So what's happened is we've got a lot of amazing kind of theology happening, and it's not just those two guys who happen to be white 20-somethings or 30-somethings, but there's tons of great theology coming out of the Latin American communities. There's great black theology that is coming from younger generations of black preachers. There's huge numbers of women who are writing and doing theology in parishes. And what we just don't have the delivery system of the old establishment culture that was already talked about over here, so the loss of that culture. So it's all decentralized and kind of noisy. Without a clear sense of direction. And what's happening is I think a lot of younger adults are sort of they're kind of interested in those things. And when they hear somebody like Jay Baker, you know, full of tattoos, saying something about theology, or Rob Bell saying that there's no hell, they kind of take notice, at least, and they want to engage in theological conversations. But there's really kind of not a lot of natural avenues of connection to have theology move in and through younger adult generations. So that's, I think it's much a sort of technological and platform disconnect as it is a I don't think we can blame it on theology.
But there are problems though that I think, you know, whether they're theologians or churches or whoever, that are particularly acute in 20-something and 30-something life that nobody has quite solved. Right? I mean, and the biggest one is the problem of the sexual revolution. If you are a single person in your 20s in the United States of America today, on the one hand, the idea of sort of living up to the traditional Christian view of, you know, chastity before marriage and so on seems almost impossibly difficult unless you're already embedded in a particular religious community. But then on the other hand, I think the struggle of a lot of more sort of progressive-minded churches has been, well, if you sort of downplay or jettison that message, then it seems like you're not taking the Christian religion seriously. And I think nobody has quite found, you know, and maybe there isn't sort of a particular answer. It's just that this era is particularly challenging in that way. But I don't know how, you know, absent sort of a direct response that speaks to problems like that, I think, you know, there is something just sort of natural about this drift. You know, we have this long period of sort of adolescence, right, that previous societies haven't had to the same degree.
I'm sorry, but our time is up. And I just want to say thank you to the Yale Divinity School for organizing this, because it's so interesting what's going on, and how it comes out is important not only for religion, but because of religion's role as kind of the foundation for everything else, it's important, very important for the whole country that we get it right.
It is.
So thank you very much to Diana Butler Bass and to Ross Douthat. Our best wishes to Eleanor and her big sister.
And to Bob Abernethy.
Thank you, Bob.
first hour, but I felt like we were kind of doing the macro 10,000 feet view. And I'm going to really push you guys to bring it down to the level of, you know, your average congregation, and how does this, all this information affect churches? And so to do that, I'm going to ask you sort of a confessional question. I'll begin with you, Diana, and then Ross, but would you tell us where you worship and on a Sunday morning?
Lately, I've been worshiping a lot on United Airlines on Sunday morning. I actually have in my iPod tapes from a monastery where I can do morning prayer. But when I'm at home, I am a member of St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Old Town Alexandria, Virginia. So I'm an Episcopalian. It's a large, successful Episcopal congregation, very diverse, and surprisingly, most of my friends are always kind of a little surprised to hear this. It's really kind of conventional. It's not entirely like the kinds of more edgy congregations that I write about. And we started going there because my daughter is 15 and she wanted a good youth group. And so I always swore I'd never be one of those parents. But there I am. I'm the youth group mom. So so that's where we are.
And you weren't raised Episcopalian?
No, I was raised United Methodist. And then spent about 15 years or so of my life as going to primarily evangelical churches. And so here I am at Yale, but hey, it's a friendly audience. I know a lot of people. I actually graduated from seminary. I went to Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary. And I also went to, yeah, look at that. They're scared now. I attended an evangelical college. So actually a huge amount of my theological formation happened among evangelical academia.
Excellent. Ross, how about you?
I attend a Catholic parish in Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., called St. Peter's.
St. Peter's and St. Paul's.
St. Peter's and St. Paul's, that's right. I'm not sure what we should make of this.
I think we could go a long way with this.
At least we know how we're going to die, right? it's a parish in the Capitol Hill neighborhood of D.C., which for those of you who know it, know that it's filled with lots of young professional couples with multiple children under the age of 6 years old. And so the church is happily very tolerant of my older daughter hollering, Mommy Mary, from the back of the church at inopportune moments. But it's actually, I would say, one of the more sort of, even though because we have two young children, we're not actually deeply involved in parish life, it's one of the more sort of successful Catholic parishes that I've been involved in since I left home. I've lived in D.C. mostly. I lived in Baltimore briefly when my wife and I were first married. She was a reporter at the Baltimore Sun, and so I have attended a lot of sort of urban or quasi-urban Catholic parishes that are sort of the, you know, relics of an era when there were a lot more Catholics in those
including St. Mary's on Hillhouse?
Not including St. No, because St. Mary's here in New Haven is where actually my whole family became Catholic when I was a teenager. So that is the immediate New Haven connection. But I mean, I think overall, you know, and this is sort of something particular to Catholicism, I think, but it's been striking to me sort of throughout my short life as a Catholic, just how much difference it makes to, you know, both the age of the priest who pastors a parish and the number of priests in residence at a parish for, you know, the sort of Catholic emphasis on sacramental life and so on. It just, you know, you can sort of see the impact of the vocations crisis in American Catholicism on lots and lots of American parishes, because there's just this sort of sense of sort of aging and overstretched priests, but happily that is not the case at the parish we attend now.
So let's talk about the people who don't go to church. Let's talk about the spiritual but not religious. And so one thing that you seem to agree on is sort of what's wrong in American culture, a sense of self-centeredness, narcissism, lack of community, you know, some of these problems. But the spiritual but not religious who don't go to church, why is that, and whose fault is it, Diana?
Well, you know, it depends upon who you're talking to. One of the things that I think is really a problem is when we look at any group and just say, oh, well, those are the nuns, or those are the spiritual but not religious. And as academic work is now being done on the folks who have left church behind, we're discovering that they're really quite a diverse crew, that there are atheists and agnostics, humanists, post-theists, people who are spiritual but not religious, people who have multiple religious identity, which is kind of an interesting and new phenomenon. So when we look at the spiritual but not religious, it's not a sort of one fault has caused all these people to leave church, but rather a whole sort of cluster, I think, of cultural movements have made a lot of people kind of give up on church. Mm-hmm. And so some people have left mad, and I would call that sort of more the atheist and agnostic crowd. They're just sort of angry. Mm-hmm. And not all, I know some very friendly atheists, by the way.
Right.
But
just the ones who comment on the Huffington Post.
Yeah, the ones who comment on the Huffington Post. That's where you see a lot of the edge. But there is a lot of,
What's up with all those atheists reading
the religion
page? The ones
who comment on the New York Times are very well-mannered,
There's a lot of anger in that community about religion. So those folks have left. But then there is woundedness. You know, people who have had terrible experience in church and just can't give it a sort of a second chance. And then there's doubt and a lot of other things going on. So I think for when we start talking about people who are spiritual but not religious or none of the above, the first thing we need to do is resist the temptation to categorize those people into easy to sort of place little sort of packets about understanding.
So what would you say is going on with that group?
Well, part of it, I mean, I think seeing the different kinds of spiritual but not religious people is incredibly important, right? Mm-hmm. Because especially in elite culture, we tend to think of it in terms of, you know, the upper middle class. This sort of goes back to one of the questions that was asked at the end of the last session, but sort of the cosmopolitan, politically and socially liberal, maybe sort of Richard Dawkins reading, or maybe just sort of, you know, agnostic and sort of doesn't think religion could possibly matter. But then you have a lot of people, and this is, you know, from a sort of non-religious point of view, the people American society should be most concerned about often, who are working class, and especially working class men, who,
that's right,
for whom it's not, there's no sort of conscious rejection of, the gospel narrative or something. It's, you know, men who aren't getting married, who are getting married and breaking up, who have, you know, who are cut off from various forms of community and who aren't being, who just aren't sort of socialized into and integrated into religious communities, and who, you know, sort of identify, you know, maybe pick up on some sort of cultural hostility to organized religion. Maybe they're, you know, watching Family Guy or laughing at a Bill Maher joke or something late at night. But it's not a sort of Richard Dawkins-esque rejection. And there, I do think it is pretty clear that there's been, I think if you look at it in terms of lines of class, that's where the clearest institutional failure right now seems to lie. Like if you look at sort of, one of the interesting trends in American life is that, you know, we have this conception that was true in the 1970s, that sort of working class America is more religious than upper middle class America. And, you know, in certain ways you can look at some poll numbers, that's still true, but in terms of church attendance, it's not. Church attendance for the upper middle class is down a little bit since the 70s, but I think in part because evangelical Christians are more likely to be college educated, also some working class Catholics are more likely to be college educated. That number has stayed pretty high, and the real collapse is in church attendance is among Americans without a college degree, and that overlaps with issues of mass immigration and stuff particular to Catholicism. But that's sort of, I think if you're looking at the clearest failure of the churches, it isn't in the sort of secular elite and so on. It's, you know, integrating downscale Americans into religious communities.
What about the American religious landscape? And in some ways, you know, your stories are paradigmatic. I was raised one thing, right, then I became an evangelical, then I became an Episcopalian. That freedom of choice. And is there a way in which we've become a nation of sort of religious dilettantes? I think of people I went to college with. I went to a Quaker college, and they would say, you know, I consider myself to be a Quaker. And I was like, does any Quaker consider you to be a Quaker? Like, do you do anything Quakerish, you know? So, I mean, what role does choice have in this?
Choice is just part of the condition of Western culture. You know, we can insult people for being dilettantes, and I'm really kind of uncomfortable with that. You know, in a very real sense, a person who was a cradle Episcopalian could accuse me of being a dilettantish Episcopalian for only having been around since 1980. And so, you know, 30 years of engagement with a tradition in some circumstance would count as being a newcomer. So I'm not willing to claim, you know, that I have kind of the magic sort of potion because I've been around Episcopal churches for 30 years. But what's happening is that all of Western culture has been sort of cut loose and become a culture based in choice. And so that's true in France, it's true in Canada, it's true in Australia, it's true in New Zealand. It's not just about Americans. It's about a philosophical switch of moving away from inherited identities towards self-constructed identities. So we can look at that as being self-centered, or we can just look at it as kind of a new philosophical circumstance in which we find ourselves. And that makes me then have more sympathy for people who are allowing themselves to kind of walk the path of the open choices that are in front of us.
But couldn't it be both, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it could be, I mean, I completely agree that it is, you know, you cannot escape the fact that this is sort of a default paradigm of Western culture today. And my own, I mean, we didn't get into it that much, but my own religious trajectory involved being born Episcopalian and spending a fair amount of time in Pentecostal. Right, we were traded. And
yeah,
they
we
threw
were.
In some prospects along with me to make it
like
to make
zero.
It a fair deal. But you know, if you look at someone like Marco Rubio, the great Republican hope, or someone, if you know a little bit about Marco Rubio, you know that he's a Hispanic and a Cuban and probably a Catholic. And if you know a little bit more, you know he's a Catholic who also attends an evangelical megachurch. And if you know a little bit more, you know that he's a Catholic who sometimes attends an evangelical megachurch who spent 3 years as a Mormon when he was a kid because his parents temporarily converted to the LDS church. So these are just the stories that we live with. But at the same time, from the point of view of sort of, you know, people who are hopefully called by religious belief to stand a little bit outside the prevailing structures of the age, you have to be able to see the sort of the dangers inherent in this kind of, you know, in a choice that doesn't actually require anyone to ultimately make a choice, right? I mean, I think that's what concerns me the most. It's not you becoming an Episcopalian after going to Gordon Conwell or something. It is the sort of the people who are nuns who think they're making choices but aren't actually making choices, because making choices requires actually picking a path and going down it at least a little way.
And depth, right? I mean, you would argue that making a choice and then going deeply into something as opposed to skimming the surface.
Right, but and this is, I think, too, where we probably disagree a little bit about sort of, you know, you were talking about sort of theological depth in contemporary American writing, and yes, some of it is just that, you know, if Time magazine put Reinhold Niebuhr on the cover today, nobody would care because Time magazine isn't what it used to be, right? That
yeah.
sort of mass culture that sustained those kind of public figures doesn't exist. And that is part of the story, that if there were, you know, the Thomas Mertons and Flannery O'Connors or whomever, they wouldn't have the same audience maybe they had 50 years ago. But I'm just a little skeptical that we actually do have those people to the same degree. And I would, to turn it away from literature for a minute, I mean, you asked sort of what are the churches doing wrong? I mean, one thing that, you know, they're obviously, you know, to each his own and so on, this is a purely aesthetic statement, but I think one of the striking things about American religion in the last 50 years is that American Christianity has gotten physically uglier in sweeping ways in church architecture and art.
Oh, I thought you meant like us. Yeah.
Well, I mean.
We're older.
Listen, I've gotten uglier in the last 2.5 years since I started showering only twice a week, but that's neither here nor there. But I think that, you know, part of the witness of Christianity is a witness of sanctity, but it's also a witness of beauty. And you don't have a sense that, you know, when you're rarely an American city where the opening of a new church or cathedral is a major architectural event, right? And, you know, there's a cycle there, right? It's partially that sacred architecture isn't as appealing a calling for architects as it was 50 years ago. You can't sort of figure out exactly where the process starts, but it is still the case, I think, that there's been a sort of loss of cohesion in the Christian message in terms of sort of how institutions relate to their physical space and to what they're surrounding people with when they walk into. I mean, this is an absolutely beautiful space, and I have been, you know, we've been doing speaking tours of various kinds, and I've been in a lot of religious spaces in the United States that are slightly less pretty beautiful. And I think that matters.
Yeah. Diana, what do you think the church is doing wrong?
Well, again, there are certainly things that churches are doing wrong, but I really think that a lot of the situation which we find ourselves in is sort of understandable human psychology in an age of enormous change. And so we have these philosophical changes that have opened up choice. And recently I was reading, I guess I like to do this on occasion, reading some marketing studies and some business books. And there was this one study that showed that if you stop people outside of a grocery store and you gave them three different kinds of ice cream, is that nearly everyone would stop and people would pick one. But if you stood outside of a grocery store and you had a table that had 25 different flavors of ice cream, only something like, I think it was 23%, less than one out of four people stopped. And then even fewer number of people would choose one of the flavors of ice cream. And so when I read this, I thought to myself, oh my gosh, it never really even occurred to me that there's sort of a human psychology of choice. And that if you have too many choices, people are sort of frozen, that they'll sort of walk past the offerings, or if they stop, they literally don't know what to do. And so, I was telling this to my husband, who I mentioned before. We talk a lot about these things. He actually is the publishing director of the Alban Institute. So we're kind of in the same conversation about congregations all the time. And he said, well, what do you suggest? If you start talking about that on the road, people are going to say, oh, well, that's the answer, is that we can only have like a Protestant church and a Catholic church and a Jewish synagogue in every town, close down all the rest, and then people can choose.
I'm just throwing it out there. But how would that witness to the inherent disunity of Protestantism? I mean, you know, there would be no Catholic polemicists. Yeah. We'd go out of business.
Watch out.
You're right.
There are bodies under this
the
chapel floor.
The incredible unity of the Catholic Church.
But I do think that is really kind of an aspect of this that church leaders don't necessarily pay attention to, is that in an environment where there's an exceedingly huge number of choices, which is just what we have, is that there's a human reaction towards that to just walk right by the table. Mm-hmm. So for church leaders, the issue is we have to figure out how to sort of get the attention of a world that's sort of walking by. And so what you suggest is one of those ways that I think is actually very compelling in 21st century beauty or practices,
things
like that.
So let's talk about the people who have never tasted ice cream, right? The people who walk by and it's not because they don't like ice cream, they've never tasted it. So the people, you know, increasingly with the rise of the nuns, N-O-N-E, we're having people who have never experienced congregational life.
Right.
And you have, on the other hand, these people who are furious with the church or have been injured by the church. Mm-hmm. And then in my congregation, you have these people who've never been a part of a church before and they've not yet been injured. You know, I'm like, give us time. We'll get to you. But it's, you know, but there's a way in which I think I hear, you know, this critique of the church and what's the church doing wrong and this and that is in some ways answering a question that group is not asking. You know, if they show up in church, they're happy to be there. How do you hold all these people together?
Ross points to one thing that I do think is deeply important in the culture, and I don't know if it's so much an issue of building new buildings, but certainly is an issue of creating spaces of beauty. That is another part of this sort of philosophical transformation we're going through in the West, is that people are finding meaning through through beauty, through art and music and all of these things. And so I do think that that is a significant way of touching the souls of people who might walk by the ice cream table. Another sort of way is storytelling. You know, over the years, certainly you and I have had any number of conversations on that score, is that there really needs to be a compelling story that congregations can tell about their encounter with God, how they serve their neighbors, who Jesus is. And in telling that story, inviting other people into the narrative and saying, you know, we're really glad you're here. This is our story, and our story is going to become better when your story links in with ours. And so I think that community of beauty, community of storytelling, that certainly those are two points of connection.
You, Ross, you would probably mention, I mean, one of the failures you've noted in your own tradition is a lack of catechesis, right?
Right, and I mean, this is where I guess we should, since I agree with what you just said, we should probably push towards terrain of disagreement, or maybe not, but because I think that, you know, part of the story with, you know, there's the paradox of choice that marketers have to deal with all the time, but there is also the power of brand identity, right? And, you know, it cuts both ways. If your brand is tarnished, as the Catholic brand, so to speak, has been deservedly so by the sex abuse crisis, then you're sort of, you're stuck with that brand. I mean, the Catholic Church can't rename itself Altria the way Philip Morris did and just sort of move on. But but it is also the case that, like, you know, if you've never had ice cream before and you're going to go buy ice cream and you look at those 25 choices, you're like, Ben and Jerry's, I'm pretty sure I've heard of that one. Haagen-Dazs, I'm pretty sure I've heard of that one. And that's if you're, you know, an upper middle class yuppie. If you're an ordinary American, maybe it's a different brand. But and that, I think, does get to the sort of enduring liberal conservative division about these issues, which is that while conceding, and I certainly would concede, that there isn't some magic conservative theological answer to these problems, I think it's still the case that the biggest reason why the more sort of tradition-minded, in different ways, religious bodies have in certain ways been more resilient in this era is that they have done a better job of maintaining brand identity. And this hasn't been entirely successful, and the breakdown in catechesis in the Catholic Church and everywhere else is obviously an example of how it hasn't been. But in the end, it is a clarity about what you believe, not on every issue, but on sort of fundamental issues, I think is a sort of, it's an essential aspect of successful religion.
Okay, and let's push on that a little bit. So in the Barna study and also the Pew study about the nuns, you know, one in five under 30 is a nun, right? N-O-N-E. And one of the things that young people are saying is a turnoff to the church and the branding is that the church is perceived as anti-gay and homophobic. So what do you think?
It is.
I mean, I think that this is an example of sort of the, you know, the kind of unsolvable problems, unsolvable in the sense of not having been solved at the moment, that that the church is facing. Because I think what happened with basically with sort of debates over sexuality is that you had the sort of, you had the sexual revolution, you had a kind of revolution in heterosexual life, right? And for a while, there was this sense that homosexuality was sort of the last redoubt of sort of traditional morality, right? It was like, okay, you know, we've accepted no-fault divorce, we've accepted premarital sex, but people are still sort of uncomfortable with homosexuality and still are certainly uncomfortable with the idea of gay marriage. But over the last 15 or 20 years, in a post-closet era, that apparent strength, it has actually turned out to be a much greater weakness, because as you think more seriously about it and come to actually know more gay people, you realize that, in fact, what traditional Christianity asks of gay people is harder than what it asks of straight people, you know, not in every specific case, but the
meaning
general...
Meaning chastity.
Meaning chastity, right, in a way that, you know, I mean, it asks chastity of straight people too, but obviously there is the possibility of having romance, sexuality, and childbearing all going together. And And so that then in turn has then sort of reflected back on the rest of Christian sexual teaching, right? Because it's like, well, and this I think you definitely see with the nuns, it's like this sort of unfairness to gay people then makes what Christianity has had to say about straight sex seem even more, you know, ridiculous, backward, unrealistic, and so on. And so you have a big problem.
It's interesting, though, that 54% of white, 54% of Catholics, not white Catholics, 54% of Catholics right now think that gay people should be allowed to be married. It's the religious group with the highest percentage, except for Jews and none of the above. Catholics are the highest percentage in favor of gay marriage. So there's a clear, see, that's the part of that disconnect piece between
right.
the mm-hmm. teaching of the church and the sort of the reconfiguring of a Christian sexual ethic that's happening in the pews.
Right, but then that reconfiguring, the problem with that reconfiguring is the problem, I think, we've talked about this before, but I think the central problem that liberal Christianity has right now in terms of living up to its desire to be a prophetic witness is that it doesn't know what to say about American sexual dysfunction. And I think it is impossible to look at American society today and not see, I shouldn't say impossible, I think it's impossible to look at American society today from any kind of a religious perspective and not see a culture that is, many of whose problems relate to sexuality in very deep and profound ways. And these are problems of broken homes, of fatherlessness, of pornography, of everything else. And they don't just sort of fit some sort of, you know, sort of Christian right stereotype. They relate to sort of how men think about women and gender roles and all of these things. And I think the problem, if the problem for sort of the conservative position is the one I've just described, the problem for liberals is that once you say, you've heard these arguments many times before, right? But once you say, this aspect of the Christian sexual tradition is going to be removed, and we're going to downplay that aspect, and we're going to talk more generally about sort of healthy sexual behavior rather than sort of chastity in particular, you seem to lose the plot. You seem to lose the thread.
Well, it isn't about removing something, but what it is, what it really has been about from inside of the liberal tradition, it has been about reformulating how we understand sexual ethics. And so what I would argue is that actually liberals, well, I'm a liberal, and you say we don't have anything to say about sexual dysfunction. Well, there's a lot of it, and
You're against it.
I'm happy to say it, I'm against it.
Yeah.
But we actually do say a lot about sexual dysfunction. Part of the whole push for the marriage of gay and lesbian people within mainstream sort of liberal tradition has been an attempt for sexual health. We were looking at sexual dysfunction. We said, well, it is highly dysfunctional to say to our members, if you happen to love a person of the same sex, you have to stick them in a closet someplace. Mm-hmm. And so what we were willing to do is to go back and look at the Christian tradition of marriage and then fundamentally ask, what does marriage mean theologically? And how does gayness fit within that story? And so liberal Christians came to a different conclusion of what marriage means theologically than conservative ones did, but it's equally as theological. It's been a deep theological journey for liberal
congregations. So I'm going to take it to sort of like a congregation, suburbs of Chicago, my congregation. And you know, we do a program that probably many people here know our whole lives. It's a sexuality, human sexuality and relationships, and trying to talk about this. And in some ways, I wonder if the mainline conversation around gay marriage, gay ordination, did sort of provoke this idea of, oops, but we haven't been talking or dealing with issues of sexuality with our young people, period. You know, and so we have to sort of circle back and do that. But to on the slippery slope question, you know, if you take one thing out, I mean, what about the evangelical move after, you know, Reagan was elected, that suddenly divorce became okay? Say something about, you know,
I mean,
what you want to say.
I think you know what I think about that move. I mean, I think I'm not sure it was specific to the case of Ronald Reagan. I think it was just a general shift that had been, you know, there had always been
a sort of somewhat, you know, Roman Catholicism was distinctive in the kind of line it drew on divorce. That was always true. But I think, you know, post-1970s, post the divorce revolution, you just had a very natural reformulation, would be a reasonable way to put it, of sort of that in turn made the, you know, in the long run, this I think wasn't apparent in the 1970s and 80s, but in the long run did make the sort of evangelical line drawing on gay marriage seem much more, you know, arbitrary and homophobic, right? Mm-hmm. That you were ending up in a place where, you know, the partisan examples are manifold, and, you know, I mean, Newt Gingrich is, of course, now a Catholic, God bless him, but the sort of, you know, Gingrich, Limbaugh, you know, the whole phenomenon of sort of right-wing phony moralists who have been married two or three or four times and so on. And so that, you know, I mean, this happened to some extent within the Catholic Church, where you had sort of annulments shift from being, you know, a sort of rare exception to being not mm-hmm. as common as divorces, but fairly common. And then the flip side of that, the arguments you'll get into within the Catholic Church is, you know, people will say, look, you know, from a theological point of view, these annulments are actually correct, because lots of people entering into these marriages don't have a genuine understanding of what a Christian marriage is. And so when it falls apart, it is a sign that it wasn't, you know, it wasn't there to begin with. I guess I look at the reformulation that liberal Christianity has attempted, and I agree, it is theological. I don't think it is theologically sound in the context of historic Christian practice and belief. And this is where that word that I use in my subtitle, that obviously is an uncomfortable word for a Catholic to use in a Protestant house of worship, comes into play. I think that shift, among many others, represented a reformulation too far. And I understand why it was done, and I'm not sitting here with sort of an answer to how the Christian churches should have dealt with no-fault divorce or anything else associated with the sexual revolution. But if you look at American culture today, the image of marriage that people have is not an image overall that seems to actually bind people into successful lifelong unions to the extent that was true in the past. And there are many deep and complicated reasons for that, but I think that there is a, you know, the sort of thinning out of ideas that, you know, sex and gender are interwoven with God's plan for creation is not a small reformulation, and it's one that does, you know, it takes you a distance from sort of, again, that Christian past. Doesn't mean that it's wrong, yeah. Obviously.
And I see what you're saying there, and there is some tendency, of course, within liberalism to say, oh, well, you know, sex is just part of God's good creation. And that's a great thing, because in a sense it's an overreaction from our Puritan heritage. Again, I feel really worried sitting in this building saying something like that. The other piece of this that actually seems to me more important than saying like who should and shouldn't get married and what marriages should and shouldn't stay together or that we're just, I think that basically churches are kind of inept dealing with sex, kind of across the board, liberal ones and conservative ones. And a more kind of fruitful direction for us in the current culture might be to say that, you know, sex is just part of kind of human brokenness. And that is, every person probably in this entire room has the experience of having walked into a relationship, whether it was sexually culminated or just a romantic relationship or of some sort or another, and you go in with all these high expectations, and this is the person you're going to love for a lifetime. And within 6 months, you're sort of tearing each other's throats out, and the person breaks up with you over Twitter, mm-hmm. you know? And so there's a
I'm sorry
excuse
to hear
me,
that.
I have to check my.
So there's a level in which I think human beings, even in a culture that is more open talking about sexuality and still looks at the church as being kind of prudish or rule-oriented regarding sexuality, even this culture with all these young adults under 30 who are spiritual but not religious, they understand the question, that they understand that sex doesn't turn out the way you necessarily mm-hmm. expect it to.
So,
and see, there's where.
But let me make it though. And
I
prudishness versus, I think mm-hmm. lumping prudishness and rule-based visions together is obviously the way things often work out, but I think that is where you should and can be able to split. And I agree, you know, I often hear people say, oh, you know, the Catholic Church is talking too much about sex or something. Let me tell you the last time I heard a sermon about sex in a Catholic church. You know, probably been 5-6 years or
come
something.
To the Episcopal
I mean,
Church,
right,
yeah.
In the Episcopal Church, yeah. Yeah. Well, but, yeah. But I think that there's absolutely room for a post. Touche. Although, yeah, well, we don't want to follow that thread. But there's room, obviously, for a post-prudish Christianity that could talk openly about these things. But when you come down to the question itself, and to pick one that, you know, isn't in the sort of specific culture war bucket, what do you tell, you know, a young man looking at pornography? You know, one option is to say, well, you know, this is, there is a healthy way to look at pornography and an unhealthy way to look at pornography. And obviously, to some extent, that's true, right? And, you know, there are ways of looking at pornography that are worse and better.
I wouldn't actually know this.
But well, again, we don't want to follow some of these threads all the way down. But at the same time, there is, you know, there is also a sense in which there is not only clarity but utility in that no. And I think that, you know, if there is a reason why the Ten Commandments are the Ten Commandments and not healthy suggestions for a meaningful life, right? I mean, there is a commandment element to religious faith that you can lose sight of if you're focused on just on sort of the health aspect. And I'm
okay, so from commandments, I want to take you guys into another area that you're going to disagree on. Oprah Winfrey, perhaps. Now, after 9/11, I don't know if you remember, but in New York, you know, everyone gathered for this massive event, and they made the decision not to invite any religious leaders to speak, and Oprah Winfrey actually spoke at it, and in a sense played the role of chaplain to the nation. What did poor Oprah Winfrey ever do to you, Ross? She is your example of one of the heresies, which is people who see the God within themselves.
No, well, let me say this, and let me use the example of Joel Osteen rather than Oprah Winfrey, because this has happened to me more often. But I've done a lot. You do a lot of radio interviews and so on when you promote a book, and you know, in the course of the radio interview, they'll say, what's wrong with American Christianity? And usually if it's a liberal host, I'll say, Joel Osteen is what's wrong. And if it's a conservative host, but I say something about Joel Osteen. What I usually say is, gets back to this holistic issue, right? I say, look at Joel Osteen and then look at Billy Graham. Joel Osteen says lots of the same things Billy Graham says. He's open-handed. He preaches a loving, universal God. He's non-sectarian and so on. But he also has lost sort of half of Graham's message, the message about human sinfulness and fallenness and the need for real redemption and real conversion and not just expecting God to deliver you the house on the corner of your street. And several times someone will call into the show and they'll say, Mr. Douthat, you know, I know what you're saying about Joel Osteen, but there was a point in my life when I just needed to hear Joel Osteen's message. And I turned on the TV, and there he was. I couldn't believe that there was a God who loved me, and he was preaching on that, and it made a huge difference in my life. And that's an incredibly important thing to hear and to think about. And in the case of Oprah Winfrey, I think you can say exactly the same thing, which is that there is a large side of Oprah Winfrey's public ministry, and I do think it is a public ministry, that is immensely positive. And it is saying things that are true about human resilience and human flourishing and human nature. It's just that I think that there is more to the story than what Oprah Winfrey tells. And
what is Oprah Winfrey's point?
Can I jump in?
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. It's really interesting to me that Oprah sort of becomes the point person for some of this cultural anxiety. There's one thing I know that Ross and I would completely agree on is that we wish she still had her book club.
mm-hmm. you know, and or to be interviewed on Oprah and to be an author meant a huge success. But you know, you can give the example of Oprah and no religious leaders being invited to the New York City event, or you can give the example of what just happened in Boston and have all religious leaders and nobody to speak for the atheists, agnostics, and humanists, humanists in the memorial service that just happened following the Boston bombing. I have a lot of good friends who are atheists who are really angry following both Newtown and the marathon attack because their voices were not included in the memorial services. So what's happening right now is we live in a moment where there's a temptation to look at the other guy and say, oh, well, you've got the microphone, you've got the stage, you've got the following, and we've got a better message, and we're kind of jealous of you. But the truth of it is that everyone in a pluralistic culture feels somewhat excluded, and there needs to be some sort of more generous and generative conversation between people who are still church people and Oprah Winfrey's of the world and the sort of the Joel Osteen's of the world, and not just those two groups. But so I look at that and I kind of always ask the other question, is not how did I feel by being excluded what happened 9/11, but instead what does Oprah Winfrey feel from being excluded from the Boston Marathon bombing? Is either one of those two things a picture of the kind of America we want to be? And where should Christians be on the front line of that conversation? You know, frankly, I'm kind of to the point where I'm just really kind of tired of insulting people. And I want to be the kind of Christian that is not busy criticizing somebody else's worldview or finding sort of theological incompleteness in it, but instead being able to just kind of sit back and say, tell me your story. And I think that that's what Ross is saying when the Joel Osteen guy calls up and says, you know, this is my story. And Joel Osteen means more than just that. There is a lot to other people's stories. And at this point in history, I'm willing to at least just listen before I jump in and start telling people what they should think.
Unfortunately, I run a newspaper column, so I don't have that luxury. So,
So what a perfect
Diana.
What a perfect segue into questions from the group. You can come up to the microphone and ask any questions you like. And as people come forward though and think of their questions, I'll throw one out. You both are parents. How would you feel if, in the future, your daughter enrolls at Yale Divinity School and chooses some kind of religious vocation or leadership?
My nephew is in the audience, so I better say, I'm very proud of him. No, I think that would be wonderful. I would be thrilled if Emma.
And you?
Is this a barbed question because she's going to be joining a breakaway Catholic sect and ordained women? And am I being watched by Catholic bishops over this channel to
see Catholic women here?
No, I will just say that if any of my children, and I mean this entirely sincerely, if any of my children get through their adolescence with a robust religious faith, then I will be very thankful.
That's right.
I'm James Clement Van Pelt. I graduated here in 2003. And thereafter, for 9 years, I coordinated our initiative in religion, science, and technology. I like to approach the situation from that point of view. The elephant in the room is kind of science and technology. And basically, from the technology standpoint, what we get back is that things are driven by technology these days. Things are facilitated, all sorts of social developments are happening faster and faster because of technology. From the standpoint of science, what we get is a model based on the idea that the universe is largely determined, that it's causally closed, that the only exception to that determinism is randomness or human intention. Ergo, there's no real basis to say that religion is not superstitious instead of supernatural, which then removes the ground for giving commandments on an absolute basis, as you mentioned. And the third thing that we get from science is that our civilization is on an unsustainable path, mm-hmm. that all the factors that make that true are accelerating, that we are sort of barreling toward some sort of a cascading collapse, of which Hurricane Sandy was like this tiny glimpse. And none of those three are being addressed by our theological education. So we're sending our students out, you know, lambs among wolves, et cetera. And that's my question.
So what was the question in that?
What do we, is that a correct perspective? Or is it okay to ignore those major things coming from science and technology?
Well, the liberal Protestant tradition, of course, would say, no, it's never right to ignore science and technology. That's how we came into being in the late 19th century, was wanting to have a sustained engagement with the very best of science. So that's a place that I want us to continue to work and to think and to be in conversation and to be passionate about. That's when Lillian asked about my daughter. The other night we were having a conversation at the dining table, and she said, why is it that we're Christians exactly? Don't we believe in science? Mm-hmm. And I stopped and I said, you've grown up in an Episcopal household. Why would you ever think if for a moment that science and religion were incompatible? And then she started off in this long sort of discussion of what she was learning in her high school science class and how she found it incompatible and wanted to know how her parents put those pieces together. So this is a very lively discussion. And I think that the old liberal tradition, which is developing into something new, certainly has to be at the front lines of engagement on this.
The Roman Catholic tradition, as you know, is to place scientists under house arrest and assume that the problem will go away. So that is actually my recommendation. I guess I would make two points. One is that I think the challenge of science and sort of the challenge of sort of scientistic modernity, if you will, is the general challenge that has faced every religious tradition over the last 500 years. Mm-hmm. I'm a little bit skeptical that it's the most acute challenge right now, only because when I go back to the sort of 1950s and 1940s and a period of greater institutional vitality and greater, I think, intellectual vitality in American Christianity, I don't see that sort of the science of that era was somehow less hostile to Christianity. I mean, I think all of the issues we wrestle with today about, you know, Darwinism and quantum physics and everything else, in certain ways, the trajectory of those debates has, I would argue, been somewhat favorable to a more sort of Mysterian view of the cosmos, if you will. And I think that often this sort of, I think that the success that figures like Richard Dawkins and others have had in pushing, sort of reviving and pushing again that Christianity versus science narrative, I really deeply think it's mostly been successful because there are these deeper tectonic shifts that we've been discussing. So while I do think that, you know, anybody preparing for any kind of public career in ministry or anything else associated with religion has to be focused on that issue, I don't think it is, I think it may be a bigger, it may be a smaller problem than it seems if you just, you know, mm-hmm. watch Richard Dawkins debating some hapless, you know, bishop or theologian somewhere. I think that sort of, you know, if you figure out sort of these underlying societal questions, the science versus religion debate is less of a problem than it seems to be. Mm-hmm. Then on the longer term question, I actually think if I were giving advice to people looking at the next 50 or 100 years, I think stagnation rather than crisis is the future facing the developed world, that whatever particular climate-driven crises we face, and I'm quite confident that we will face some of them, the bigger trajectory of the West is a trajectory of an aging society, a society where growth seems to be slowing down, in part because of demographic reasons, a society of, you know, incredible abundance, but fewer people working, especially downscale, less educated people, and it's a portrait of sort of stasis and slowness more than sort of acute apocalyptic you know, finales. So that's sort of my apocalyptic vision is more stagnative than crisis driven.
For what it's worth, my next book, which I recently have sort of talked my publisher into, the tentative title of it is Sustainable Faith. And it's actually trying to deal with some of these trends around austerity, stagnation, growth, simplicity, all these themes that are so mealy right now in our culture. And what kind of theology is there? What kind of theological resources do we have to speak God in and through this particular world?
Jared?
Yeah, I have a comment from Heidi, who's watching online. She identifies as a Mennonite, and she points to the rise of monastic communities and other kinds of alternative traditionalist communities, and wonders, what does that mean? Is that something that's going to continue? Is that the future? Is it a temporary reaction to the kind of environment we're in?
It might be a temporary reaction, but right now it's a pretty strong temporary reaction. One of the weirder sorts of demographic blips that have occurred in American religion the last couple years is that one of the few denominations growing are the Amish. And they have high birth rates, and they also are having some success right now with conversion from people who are sort of trying to come out of the, who are choosing them, right. out of the flux of choice. They are picking that kind of simple boundaried community as the place to invest their lives.
And I would say that this is actually another place where the sort of liberal, the sort of lines between liberal and conservative Christianity break down a bit. And it is, I think, the attractiveness of, you know, a figure like Stanley Hauerwas and figures like that to young people is precisely this sense of sort of getting beyond the culture war debates of the 70s and 80s and figuring out a way to live Christianity more directly. And I think the question for the culture as the whole is, what is that, you know, what are those kind of communities the seeds for? Or are they, as I think you would worry, maybe rightly, just sort of ultimately it's just a form of self-segregation, and we'll find out.
That's right, we will find that one out.
Let's make sure we get these two questions.
My name's Lorden Ignacio. I've had a question. You noted that there's a steep decline in the membership of people and religions for the Western world. It was also noted that that's not indicative in places such as South America, Africa, and even in Asia. You discussed also some of the problems, why that might be the case here in the Western world. So is it so much that it's a problem with religions in the Western world, or is there something that's being done right by those religions that are still in developing countries? And can religions now in the Western world learn from those religions that you can't see a decline in their membership?
You know, that question is fantastic, because one thing that I think is happening in Africa and Asia and Latin America is that there's a decline in the religious groups that people have traditionally adhered to in those countries. So you look at in Latin America, it used to be Catholic, and now what's happening is people are leaving the established church and they are becoming Pentecostals and evangelicals, and that's been going on for some 20 years. And in parts of Africa, people are leaving tribal faiths and other forms of religion that they've had locally for a long, long, long time, and they're joining Anglicanism. So I think it's really kind of a sign of the same thing, because the cultural context is so entirely different, it looks like, oh, Christianity is growing. Well, Christianity was never there in the first place, or it was there in such different forms that it was disconnected from the life of the community. And what's going on in many of those settings is people are abandoning distanced, kind of failing traditions, or traditions they feel like just don't work anymore, communism in China, and instead are taking on a more personal, more experiential faith.
And historically, I mean, American Christianity has always been renewed by immigrants. I mean, Reinhold Niebuhr grew up speaking German at home. And, you know, the Catholic Church in the U.S. would obviously not exist without the Irish Church and so on. And so I live in D.C. When you drive around the suburbs of D.C. and what you see are Vietnamese Catholic churches and, you know, Latin American Pentecostalist churches. I think the question in the West is just to what extent does that sort of you know, does that zeal then translate into our cultural context? And is it just, I mean, I think one way of thinking of it is Christianity, like anything else, seems more attractive when it seems new and fresh.
Right.
And so
that's
the
right.
challenge, in a sense, for churches in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
Is
to
say, how does it seem like you're abandoning animism for Christianity, right? I mean, how do you get that feeling in our context?
So, you know, Glenn Beck has this policy.
I knew you were going to quote Glenn Beck before
where
I did.
Anybody who works for Glenn Beck and says the word Obama, they get fined $20. And so that's what I think I'm going to do with mainline Protestants now. Anybody that mentions Reinhold Niebuhr.
They'll just start talking about Richard. Now. Just...
I'm going to fine you $20.
It's wonderful to be here. And I promise to be brief. My name is Anne Marie Murray, and I'm a singing grandma evangelist.
Oh.
And I have to say that your comment about telling them who Jesus is, that to me nailed this whole meeting, because Christianity is not really a religion. It's a relationship with the person of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And it doesn't matter what the label is on your denomination. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he died for your sins and shed his blood and rose again so that you could have eternal life, you've got him. You've got Christianity. And I think there are a lot of Christians, people who call themselves Christians that, and I'm not throwing stones or judging, but there's a big difference between being a Christian and being a disciple of Jesus Christ. And I had the honor of meeting Brother Rommel, and we shared that while we were having coffee. But God bless you all, and continue to preach the word. I mean, this is what we got, because the world is lost, and there's only one hope, it's Jesus. He's Jesus Christ, the only hope.
This liberal Episcopalian says, amen.
Shall we let him jump in real quick?
I think I'm gonna call.
Oh, actually, okay.
Yeah, so this is the decanal duty, is to bring this to a conclusion, but not before all of us thank Ross and Diana and Lillian and Bob one more time. Thank you.